So good morning, everybody, and congratulations, Rosatom, for this conference. Thank you very much for inviting me. I've been asked to speak for 10 minutes to give an international perspective. What I'm going to do is share with you very, very quickly some key messages from international companies that have been practicing knowledge management. Not necessarily the nuclear industry, but every sector, because the principles of knowledge management are the same. The second thing I will do, in my capacity of chairman of the Knowledge Management Standards Committee of British Standards and International Standards Organization, is give you a very quick update on the development of international knowledge management standards. Next slide, please. So I'm based in Cambridge, UK. I founded Knowledge Associates in 1995. We're based in an innovation hub which belongs to St. John's College, Cambridge University. Next slide. I was especially inspired by the late Professor Peter Drucker, who said in his management book, Management Challenges for the 21st Century, that the big challenge for management in the 20th century was to increase productivity of manual working, the industrial economy, and management have done a great job in doing that. 50-fold increase in productivity. He said the challenge for the 21st century is for management to increase the productivity of knowledge work. And I suggest to you, we're at the beginning, and this is the most important challenge for management. Next slide, please. I started in 1998 working with the UK government. The UK had major problems. Productivity in the industrial economy, in the global economy, was falling rapidly for the UK. We could not compete with quality and cost of the rest of the world, especially Asia. But we developed a government white paper to say, in addition to trying to compete in the global industrial economy, the key challenge is to compete in the global knowledge economy, to develop the skills and competencies around creativity, co-creativity, innovation, and effective knowledge management. That was the challenge of the white paper to help the UK become competitive in the global knowledge economy. Next slide. In 2000 to 2003, we were part of a 2 million euro funded research program by the European Commission that recognized that knowledge assets are key. Knowledge assets are not just codified knowledge. They are, of course, key knowledge assets. But people who create knowledge are the key knowledge assets in any organization. The technologies that distribute knowledge are key knowledge assets. The tools and technologies and methods and strategies to apply knowledge are key knowledge assets. Rather like managing electricity, it's invisible knowledge, but it's the generators of electricity, the distributors of electricity, and the application that's important. That's what knowledge asset management is about. And we started to develop methods and tools to measure and report. Next slide. In 2007, I was invited by the Asian Productivity Organization. It represents 22 Asian countries, and they're based in Tokyo. And the mission of APO is to increase the productivity of Asia. They realized in 2007 the wisdom of Peter Drucker. They realized that we need to increase the productivity of Asia's knowledge work. Next slide. And so we have developed 6 books already on knowledge management across Asia. And right now we are on our 7th book to publish later this year on increasing the knowledge productivity of Asia. Next slide. Bringing you up to 2015, some of you may have already noted that in January 2015, there was a good Harvard Business Review entitled Managing Your Mission Critical Knowledge. The key message here is that knowledge management is not about managing all the knowledge, it's about identifying, focusing on the key critical knowledge that if you manage it better will make a big difference to achieving your organization's objectives. Next slide. So we have been working with knowledge asset management with universities in Cambridge, and I'm glad to say that in January 2015 our knowledge asset management module was accredited for towards a master's degree, a higher level postgraduate. Next slide. And we are also launching in 2016 a master's focusing on the global knowledge economy, knowledge asset management, and knowledge productivity. Next slide. And so if we look around the world, it was probably the World Bank who first introduced in 1998 a measurement of every country in the world, how well it's managing its knowledge as a country, based on 4 pillars: entrepreneurship and the climate for entrepreneurship, education, how well are we teaching our children and our higher school students how to manage knowledge. The third is having an information technology infrastructure to support this. And the fourth is having the right innovation networks and hubs and connections between government, academia, and industry. Next slide. So the World Bank started to change its mind from being a bank that provides money to a bank that provides knowledge. And then, secondary to that, is the money to apply that knowledge. So they became a knowledge bank. Next slide. A few more examples. In 2003, I worked with Hong Kong Telecom. 10,000 engineers every day go and fix problems, telecommunications problems. They changed their mindset. They decided that instead of 10,000 engineers fixing problems, they would be 10,000 knowledge workers who would talk with customers to find out what customers needed. They transformed their engineers into a knowledge-driven force, still fixing problems. Next slide. All the big companies, oil companies for example, Shell for example, do not say anymore they are oil exploration and oil refining and oil distribution. Instead, they say our business is the business of the best knowledge of oil exploration. Who explores is a secondary decision. The best knowledge of oil refining, who refines is a secondary decision, and so on. They become more knowledge-driven in their thinking. Next slide.
Airbus Industries have been doing operational knowledge management for 15 years. They're very good at it in Toulouse, southwest France. I met with the chief knowledge officer. He said to me that based on that knowledge, they have created knowledge as a product, and they now say they can make more profit selling aerospace knowledge to China than ever making aeroplanes. That's a knowledge-driven mindset. Next slide. I'm conscious of time, so I'll go quickly. Toyota say every decision in their company must be knowledge-driven first. Next slide. Here, in 2013, when Mr. Yakunin was the president of Russian Rail, we signed a five-year memorandum of understanding with the university to work with the Russian Rail corporate university to help to develop higher education programs for management around knowledge economy and knowledge asset management. Next slide. So there are many benefits. I don't have time to go through the benefits, but let me just say there are operational benefits to reduce costs by not reinventing the wheel, by not repeating the same mistakes, by better reusing what we already know. The most important for me is the strategic benefits, not just to continuously improve, which is vital, but to also transform the organization, applying its key knowledge assets. So next slide. Finally, just to give you an update on knowledge management standards. In 2000, I was the chairman of the British Standards Institute Knowledge Management Standards Committee. We decided that it was too early to have a knowledge management standard. The discipline was changing rapidly. Tools and technologies are changing rapidly. But then last year, the International Standards Organization decided to proceed with the development of a knowledge management standard. And so we are now looking at that standard. I can report to you today that so far the first draft of the standard is almost complete. The first meeting was in USA last year. The next meeting is in Europe, in Berlin, in May, to consider the standard, draft one. The third meeting is in Asia, in Singapore, in August, to further consider the standard. And I can share with you that the standard is principles driven. It's not just best cases and best practices, as important as they are, but it's defining the key principles of effective knowledge and knowledge asset management and how they should be applied in all our industries. So I'll leave you with five messages that I think are important that I've learned. Next slide. The first one is that, next slide please. Is there a next slide? There, but not. I do apologize. So the first message is that I'm sure everybody in this room knows well, but it's good to remind ourselves. The web has radically and fundamentally changed the economics, the processes, and the tools of knowledge. And we've heard that already so far today. We need a new knowledge economic theory, not just based on the industrial economy of scarcity and supply and demand, because knowledge is shared and it expands. We need a new economic theory. The second slide, please. is that all of us know that, again with the web primarily, that the globalization and democratization of knowledge is with us today. It's no longer, I have some knowledge that you don't have to compete with. We can all get that knowledge much, much faster today. Today the challenge is our ability to recreate and renew knowledge faster than anyone else. That's the challenge, that process. Next slide, please. Knowledge is not just important, knowledge is not just a factor of production. I would argue strongly that knowledge is the key factor of production for every organization today. The key factor of production. Next slide. And therefore, effective knowledge management means that it's the new wealth creator of the 21st century. And my final slide, next slide, is my belief that those organizations that manage their knowledge assets wisely, in my opinion, will be the new companies that dominate the 21st century. I was very glad to hear this morning the move towards open knowledge and integrated knowledge. This is absolutely right. And I hope that the standards, when they emerge, will also be a first step towards integrated, open, global knowledge. Thank you very much.
Спасибо, тогда в кулуарах. Пожалуйста, спасибо, господин Мерц.